Bruce DuMont back in hour number two of Beyond the Beltway. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. Patrick Hanley is our Democrat. He is in studio with me this evening. And Stephanie Hitt joins us. She is our card-carrying Republican. And joining us for this hour of the broadcast is one of the country's leading political writers, William Schneider, who for many years was with CNN. He now is a writer for The Hill. And also he's author of numerous books. And the most recent one is A Standoff, How America Became Ungovernable, and he is a professor emeritus from George Mason University. And Bill, it's nice to have you with us back on Beyond the Beltway.
Thank you. Good to be here, Bruce.
I'd like to begin by picking up the discussion from hour number one. We were talking a little bit about 2022 and 2024, and I know that your recent article in The Hill deals with how the Democrats and Republicans are going to be jockeying for position to see who has the upper hand come November of 2022. At this moment in time, and I realize it can change from day to day, if you were to be handicapping who is most likely to have the momentum on Election Day, who would it be?
The Republicans. Midterm elections are almost always good for the party outside of the White House. Mm-hmm. Right now, the White House is controlled by the Democrats, President Biden, and the Republicans stand a very good chance of taking over both houses of Congress. They only need to gain one Senate seat and I think five House seats to gain control of both houses of Congress, and the prospects are pretty good. The average for the party that's out of the White House in the last 10 midterm elections has been much bigger than that, about 25 House seats and about three Senate seats. So it doesn't look unlikely that Republicans will gain control of both houses of Congress simply based on the record.
Now, you have said that insofar as national issues, that the majority of people may favor the Democratic position on national issues, but that individual state governors are taking positions which are anathema to Joe Biden. And because of that, there is almost a bipolar nature of where the voter might be. They might favor the Democrats on some economic issues, whereas maybe they agree with a Republican governor on the mandates and some of those issues and how they're dealing with COVID. Do you see that as the principal sort of issues to be watching? I mean, I looked at the video the other day that came in on Fox from these, you know, over 10,000 people coming across the southern border at Del Rio, Texas. And I said to myself, oh, my God, here's video that's just writing commercials for Republicans to take back Congress.
That's right. The surge of they're really refugees, not migrants. They're mostly Haitian refugees. That could be a big problem. President Biden is sending them back to Haiti. Mm-hmm. And that is making progressive Democrats very angry. Mm-hmm. It could work to his advantage in the midterm election. We just don't know. But it's certainly not a good sign. For Republicans, the midterm election is supposed to be, and usually is, a referendum on the president. And they hope a negative referendum on the president. It usually is. The only two midterms where the president's party has picked up seats were exceptional circumstances. Mm-hmm. In 1998, just before Bill Clinton was impeached by the House of Representatives. And in 2002, shortly after the attacks on the World Trade Center and the Pentagon on September 11th, those were exceptional circumstances. And in both cases, the president's party made gains. Well, Republicans are hoping this will be a negative referendum on President Biden. But President Biden, I'm sure, and many state governors like Governor Newsom in California have plans to make it a different referendum, mm-hmm. a referendum on Republican extremism mm-hmm. in the states, because Republicans in places like Georgia, Texas, South Dakota are passing laws on abortion, on voter registration, and on the pandemic that are very unpopular.
I want to ask our in-studio Democrat, Patrick Hanley. Patrick, when you saw the video at the border the other day at Del Rio, Texas, did you think, as I did, boy, this is horrible video for the Biden administration? and that it was going to start a battle between the progressives in the party that are saying, you know, don't send these people back, mm-hmm. and obviously the average American who may not be real political, but they see something like that and they say, why the hell are we letting 11,000 people into our country and we're not vaccinating them?
Mm. My first instinct, to be honest with you, is empathy and sympathy for the folks at the border. I mean, this is an incredibly difficult situation that they're in. In the week that followed, we've deported about 3,000-4,000 of them, more to come.
Did that surprise you? It surprised me.
You know, Joe Biden has always been a centrist guy. Like, he's always played down the middle of the road, especially on immigration issues. We'll all remember Barack Obama's immigration plan way back in the day, which was basically to provide amnesty for the folks that are here, a path to citizenship, as well as stronger border enforcement. I mean, Obama was slandered by the left as deporter in chief. So, no, it wasn't a huge surprise. To Bill's points earlier, I do think we are in an exceptional time, excuse me. And as we come out of the coronavirus pandemic, with any luck at all, over the next 6 months, with a stronger economy, with a country that has passed through the worst pandemic in 100 years, with some elements of the Build Back Better agenda, which are some pretty unprecedented levels of spending in parts of the economy that desperately need it, we could have a very strong, popular president heading into the midterm.
Stephanie, a question to you. When you heard or read that the Biden administration was taking many of the people who were coming in from Haiti and putting them on a plane and sending them back, does the president get credit for that?
Well,
because that's not what the progressives in the party wanted to do.
I feel like it raises a lot more questions, and that is, where are you sending them back to, first of all?
Haiti.
Well, how is this going? But they're not all from Haiti. That's, I think, part of the problem. Is that there's this knee-jerk, we're watching a knee-jerk reaction to a problem that should never have been created in the first place. And I think that's what Americans see when they see that.
But I'm wondering, can a Republican who hates the idea of people sneaking into the country,
right,
can you acknowledge that in this particular case, and by the way, I hate that concept as well,
yeah,
can you acknowledge that if you have a president who at this particular time understands that he's going to take some heat from his progressive base by taking these people, putting them on a plane, and sending them back?
Yeah,
I mean, I was advocating that 8 or 9 years ago, the first time I ever went to the border.
Yeah.
But doesn't Joe Biden get some applause for doing that?
No, because he's only responding to
reality,
to what a reality that he created. And it's, you know, and that is by opening the border.
So how did he create that, in your view?
Well, I mean, he created this open border policy that's having people come by tens of thousands.
Policy. That's simply not true.
What is the open border policy?
The southern border is wide open. Come on.
It's
in.
Not. It's not. All of these refugees have been processed by hundreds of folks working for the Customs and Border Patrol, who've been processing these folks all day, every day for weeks now. If anything, I compare this to the Afghanistan situation, where Joe Biden has faced a strategic mistake, a strategic problem created by world circumstances. And frankly, after the first hit, has dealt with them very well.
All right. When we come back, I want to pick up on that, Bill. You have some follow-up questions for Stephanie and the rest of our panel this evening. 1-800-723-8029. We've got callers on the line, I promise, to engage you when we come back on Beyond the Beltway. Thanks for joining us tonight. Back and Bill Schneider, you were trying to interrupt and ask a few questions to Stephanie Hitt, so we go back to you for your questions or further comments on this issue.
The question was very simple. What is this open border policy she was talking about? I don't know of any open border policy, except the closest is for Afghan refugees who supported the United States during the recent war. We're admitting a lot of them, and I am astonished at how welcoming Americans have been to the Afghan refugees coming to the United States.
Well, I think what the open border policy that I'm talking about is the one that's very obvious on our southern border right now, coming in through Texas and New Mexico and so on. And that is, you know, thousands on a daily basis coming up through Mexico, how they get to Central America and Mexico, but I mean, we are processing people at that border from all kinds of countries, all over Africa, for example.
Let's back up.
I want to
back up this track right now, because in the last segment we did talk about the Haitians, okay?
Right.
And that's
right.
been in the
and
news lately, okay? Yeah. All right, you don't walk from Haiti to Central America. So my question is, how do they get there?
Many of these people have come from Haiti to different places like Guatemala and so on, and they're making their way up to the southern border.
Patrick, you're saying that there was a policy that the Haitians were aware of, that they were going to be treated as refugees if they made that trek and came to the United States.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. What I understand to be the case is that following...
So if that's true, Bill, I hear you saying that is true as well. Shouldn't there have been some time between the moment they landed, wherever they landed in Central America, to the moment that they got to the border, that we don't have the video of 11,000 people walking across the Rio Grande River, which was the video from last week?
Right.
Shouldn't at some point there should have been some interception in Mexico where U.S. and Mexican authorities were processing these people, providing them with COVID shots? Because, again, Haiti has one of the lowest rates of vaccination in the world. I mean, it seems to me that no one should have been surprised with 11,000 people showing up at that border.
Yeah, I hear you. Listen, I don't know.
I believe they're under a bridge right now.
Yeah.
Right. They are under a bridge.
Bill, do you have, in the people that you talk with, I mean, when you're talking to a member of Congress, regardless of their party, do they ask aloud the question like I just asked? There had to be days of preparation that the government could have taken to not be surprised by 11,000 people knocking at your southern border.
So why didn't that happen? I want to
hear from Bill. I want to know how many members of Congress that you talk with sort of think practically like that on how something like that could happen. The Biden administration clearly reacted to it. Go ahead.
Smugglers. Most of the people coming to the United States through the southern border are transported by smugglers who know how to get around and sometimes bribe the American authorities. It's a shocking situation. But smugglers are paid a lot of money, often by entire villages in Central America, to smuggle people into the United States. I've been to the border, as you say you have, and I've seen the operations. They have telescopes across the Rio Grande where they keep track of the people that they're smuggling into the United States. Smuggling is the major source of this problem.
If you're a voter or you're listening to this program tonight, Bill, and again, you've been covering this story for 30 plus years, so have I. And obviously it bubbles up every once in a while. I mean, it clearly was the issue that I think drove Donald Trump to the White House, or certainly propelled him to the White House. And yet the average person on the street, they pull their hair out when they ask this basic question that I just asked. And they come back, well, why don't we put more troops on our southern border? Why don't we take the troops that are coming home from Afghanistan, and why don't we put them in Del Rio, Texas?
Yeah.
And what's the answer to that question?
Well, that is...
I don't think we want to militarize the border.
Whatever party's in power.
Now, you don't want to militarize the border. Are we, Bill, prohibited under the Posse Comitatus? Are we prohibited from militarizing the border?
Militarizing.
I'll say
I think there are laws. I'm not sure what the laws are, but I think there are laws about sending troops for that kind of a task, which is ordinarily done by the Border Patrol.
Right.
But I'm not. I can't cite the laws.
No.
I don't know them. I'm not a lawyer.
But what I'm saying is that maybe that's a law that needs to be reviewed and repealed, or certainly discussed, because I can't believe I'm the only person that's thinking that there's a missing position of common sense here that doesn't appear to touch base.
By the way,
speaking of touching base, we have people that have called. They've been waiting a long time. Let's go to Ronaldo. He's listening to us tonight on KTSM in El Paso, Texas. Go ahead, Ronaldo. You're on the air.
Yes, my name is Ray. last week, Biden was talking about he's going to tell the bankers to audit the people, yes, their customers, yep, of how much money goes in and comes out. So I'm saying, okay, that's good, but I hope, is it going to go to the Demos and Republicans too? Because that's where the swamp problem is in Washington. And then concerning the border, we have to rule by law, not by sympathy. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Bruce.
Okay, thank you for your call. Let's go to Robert, who's also listening tonight. He's in Sacramento, California, on KTKZ. Go ahead.
Thank you for taking my call. And I agree with what the previous caller just said. Yes, rule by law. I was just going to point out, as far as the, I guess, this fiscal inequality that was being brought up at the last mm-hmm. session. I'm on Wikipedia's page right now. The top 25 richest people in America, only two are Republicans. And I appreciate the person from the left wing, shall we say, who's speaking of called fiscal inequality,
sure,
might want to embrace that as well. No poor person has ever given me a job.
Well,
I've earned every job I've taken, and no poor person has ever given me one.
I'm an equal opportunity taxer. I'm very happy to take those Democratic billionaires' dollars just as much as the Republicans.
If you want to talk a flat tax, great, I'm right there with you. I'd be happy to discuss it with you.
What about his broader point that poor people don't hire anybody? Patrick?
I think we've faced trickle-down economics in the 80s, and frankly, the data shows that it just doesn't work. When you give rich folks incentives to hire poor folks, they don't do it. They don't spend as much as they should, and they don't pay them as much as they're productive. So at the end of the day, what you have is this place where... Yeah, go ahead.
It's such a misconception based on how economics really works, and that is that this idea that somehow the rich people hoard their money as opposed to reinvesting, yeah, employing, educating, building, growing their wealth, growing an industry.
Educating
Bill Schneider,
from the public, right?
A question to you, again, because you've gone through this many times. Thank you very much for your caller. In Washington, the battle between the Republicans and the Democrats over what is rich and who pays their fair share, that's been debated for 50 years now. Is there any one party that seems to be having the upper hand in winning that battle for the hearts and minds of the American people? Because the Democrats they got a lot of chips in that bucket at the moment.
Well, there's neither party that's winning that argument, and there's a good reason for it. Something very important has changed in American politics in the past 20 years, and that is that there are an awful lot of upper middle class and even wealthy people, as the caller said earlier, who have become Democrats.
Mm-hmm.
Wealthy people are very often the Democrats' people. That's because of what I call the new rule in America. It has been true for about 100 years. The wealthier you are, the more likely you are to be a Republican. That's still true. But it's also true now, and this is new, that the better educated you are, the more likely you are to be a Democrat. Hmm. When I tell my students that, they say, what if you're wealthy and well-educated? And I point out, that's when you're called cross-pressured. You're pulled in different directions. If you're wealthy and well-educated, if you vote your economic interests, you're going to vote Republican, as they've been doing for many decades. Yeah. But if you vote your cultural values, you're going to vote Democratic. Hmm. And that's the key condition of American politics right now. A lot of Democrats are very nervous about taxing the rich because I've heard them say, well, the rich, they're our people. They vote Democratic. And what we saw last year in the election was that large numbers of affluent suburban voters abandoned the Republican Party of Donald Trump mm-hmm. because they couldn't stand his values mm-hmm. and went Democratic. That's been changing for a long time.
Is there anything that you have heard said by Donald Trump since he has left the White House that you feel would make people rethink in 2022 as to who they would vote for a member of Congress from just those Republicans who rejected Donald Trump?
No, not really. I mean, he's complaining about Joe Biden all the time,
yep.
but he doesn't have to say those complaints. A lot of people are saying those complaints.
How's he doing with independence, though? Is that message still playing with independence?
Well, Biden is losing support among independents. I don't think it has anything to do with Donald Trump.
Okay.
Independents include a lot of young people who don't like Donald Trump. But Biden is really slipping among independents, and that's a real danger sign.
At this moment in time, we got a long way to go before 2024, let alone 2022. When we come back, I want to get your assessment, because you've known Joe Biden for 35, 40 years. I want to get your assessment as to how you think this presidency is weighing on him personally as well as politically. I'm Bruce DuMont, back shortly. Bruce DuMont back, and thanks very much for joining us. Stephanie Hitt is our Republican in studio. Patrick Hanley is our Democrat in studio. And our man in the middle is Bill Schneider, who is professor emeritus now at George Mason University. He writes for The Hill, which is one of the major inside political rags, or not rags, I guess. Rag.
Is that what you say, Bill?
I meant rags in a very affectionate
way. In a trade
way.
Kind of way.
In a trade way. Trade.
But it's mostly online.
And yeah. It's mostly online, so you can't do anything with it. But again, he is also
you author. You can't of, wrap your birdcage in.
author of many books, including Standoff, How America Became Ungovernable. It's a great book. And again, he is a longtime friend of the show. I think you've been doing this program for well over 30 years. We first met during the primary of 1983 for mayor of the city of Chicago. And we spent a lot of great time going from ward committeeman office to ward committeeman office on election night. So we go back a long way. Nice to have you back on the program, Bill. And again, the title of the book is Standoff, How America Became Ungovernable, and it's available at Amazon. Let's go to Pennsylvania right now, Western Pennsylvania, and Tom is listening to us tonight on WPIC. Go ahead, Tom.
Yeah, Bruce. I want to go back to the statement about the midterm elections. Number one, I think that financial investors disclosure needs to be put in place, that past performance doesn't necessarily indicate future results.
Mm-hmm.
What would happen, and this is a bit of a curveball, understand it, what would happen if, but it has some grounding here, because Nancy Pelosi brought the question of the 25th Amendment, but she also said it didn't apply to Trump. That's not why she was asking. And Biden gets in there. So, you know, obviously she had some concerns. Also, there was an interview with Biden, and I heard one time on one of the conservative national programs, where Biden was being interviewed, and he said, it was a question about his age. He said, well, you know, if there's a problem and I'm not doing the job, I'll do the same thing I said to Barack. I'll find something and I'll just step aside. Wouldn't it be in the Democrats' best interest if he doesn't come up in the polls? And then really, I think that there's an agenda here that is being successful. It's to make America mediocre again, that is being performed in the office right now. If we get into, say, March of next year, and Biden is at where he is now or even lower, of getting him to step aside, resigning, saying to him, you know, look, Joe, you're going to either be impeached or we'll have to take you out by the 25th Amendment. And they can even go through his wife, you know, through that process. And get him out of there. Harris becomes president. And then the new person that comes in as vice president, that see, again, they would then have still, the Democrats would still have control by having control of the House of Representatives. And even though they wouldn't have a 50-50 vote in the Senate, they would have popular pressure put it on, well, let's back the new president. Okay. Let's get somebody in there that, you know, she wants, that she's
well,
designating.
Let me just interrupt you, okay? And I know you've spent a lot of time thinking about this just to be able to articulate it and share it with everybody. I want to go back. I want to bring Bill Schneider in because this is in his landscape, his backyard, Washington D.C. and I want to sort of encapsulate the thought with something that you address in your current article in The Hill, and that is that if the Republicans were to regain control of the House, you said they would probably want to go to impeach Joe Biden. I guess my question is, why would they want to do that with 2 years to go if the person waiting in the wings would be Kamala Harris, who they may be more concerned about and worried about than Joe Biden with 2 years to go? Bill?
The Democratic Congress moved to impeach Donald Trump after he had lost re-election.
Right.
He impeached him.
Well, I know.
I mean, my God, impeachment is ordinary tool of partisan warfare today. It's like the filibuster. It used to be extraordinary, but now it's just part of the it's a partisan weapon that's used all the time. So, yeah, they've already talked about impeaching Biden. Lindsey Graham said he would move to impeach Biden for the way he handled the withdrawal from Afghanistan. He thought that was an impeachable offense. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, impeachment is a weapon. Just about everything has been weaponized these days, and impeachment is one of them.
Do you think that's a good idea, Stephanie, as a Republican?
I don't, because I, you know, especially when you're a Republican who wants to, defend, you know, like say impeachment is an extraordinary measure, then you should act as that way. But I want to kind of dial back, and the question is, Harris. You know, if you impeach Joe Biden, you get Kamala Harris. I know there
With
are
Nancy Pelosi is
yeah, well right
away.
And so here's the question, and I'd be curious to hear what Bill thinks about this. Is I believe the word on the street is that she is even more unpopular than he is. So the question is, why would anyone seek to? I don't think the Republicans. I don't think they're strategic enough anyway to think that. Okay, let's impeach Joe Biden. Let's create some turmoil before the midterms, and we'll have a really unpopular person, Kamala, to run against as our 22 theme.
Bill, I want to ask you the question because that was kind of a convoluted response too. But let me ask you this question: do you agree with what Stephanie said that she has heard that Kamala Harris is very unpopular amongst the political society of Washington? Is that true or not?
It's not really true. I mean, she's not unpopular. She's not very popular. She's more or less like exactly like Joe Biden. She's his chosen vice president. Her popularity is in the mid-40s. Biden's popularity is in the mid-40s. She is where Biden is. Every vice president is like that. The vice president is the shadow of the president.
A question that we did not talk about in hour number one very much, but I want to spend some time talking about it now, and that is the way that we've extricated ourselves from Afghanistan. Again, you've spoken with Republicans and Democrats on both sides of the aisle, and they've all been somewhat critical. How hurtful is his handling of Afghanistan as a political issue? Is it one that people are still going to be talking about in 2022?
You're asking me?
Yeah.
We don't know. I mean, Afghanistan could be forgotten by 2022. Yeah. I remind you that from 2003 to 2011, we were in Afghanistan and the war just disappeared from the political agenda. Yeah. It was displaced by the war in Iraq. And in fact, after the war in Iraq finally ended, after all those years, people looked around and they said, wait a minute, what are we doing in Afghanistan? Nobody, very few people, remembered why we were there in the first place, because it dated all the way back to 9/11 in 2001. We don't know whether Afghanistan will remain an issue. We know that it was very damaging. I think the principal damage that it did to Biden was it really undermined his image of competence, which is one of the reasons he got elected. He was seen as not handling that very competently at all, even though most Americans supported the idea of withdrawal from Afghanistan, and they had long since given up on that war. They thought it was not worth fighting. Nevertheless, They thought that the way we withdrew just revealed the president's lack of real competence.
Can I? And go ahead, Patrick.
Yeah, can I just ask a provocative question? I mean, sure. As we head into next summer, and if we forget the details of how things came about, but if COVID-19 is winding down after a brutal 2 years for the world and for the country, if we have ended the war in Afghanistan, and if Biden has either the bipartisan infrastructure package passed as an act or the $3.5 trillion of spending for the Build Back Better plan, don't you think that those are three pretty considerable successes that he can run on into 22 that could energize independence?
You know, one of the things...
If that turns out.
Yeah. Sure. I think one of the things that people are underestimating is not just the issue of competence, but credibility. And that really came under fire, especially as we see Milley, for example, what happened with the drone strike and so on. And as a military member and someone whose family is very entrenched in the intelligence community, I will tell you this, and that is that there is no trust in the rank and file anymore in some of these decisions. And people are seeing that the not just the incompetence, but the lack of credibility, the
also,
willingness
but
to lie.
Wouldn't you also say that the general public may feel the same way about the brass, not just the rank and file?
Exactly.
Because we have
it's exactly the case.
If regardless of, or I guess wherever your political support is, I mean, Joe Biden has said he followed the directions or the suggestions of his military. Now, there seems to be some debate over that.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, again, if the military people really did say, okay, you can give up Bagram and it'll be okay. I mean, I would like to know that. And I would hope that the hearings that are about to take place in the next couple of weeks, I hope they would get to that, because I would like to know that answer. Was he freelancing? Right. Was this just one of his bad ideas, as Robert Gates said about Joe Biden? Or, were there brass out there, including General Milley, saying, we can deal with this?
Well, and I think what we're going to see is, I think what we've seen and the dramatic results is it's not just about competence. There's a strong sense across the country that we have now seen proof that some of the institutions, we have some of the best institutions in the world, are now political. And people don't trust our institutions,
like
CIA,
the Supreme Court,
our FBI. We don't, everything
well,
has become
political.
Well,
they might be wrong. But one of the reasons why we don't trust them is they may not be right all the time. And that's something we have to accept.
But admitting error
have to pause.
Is different.
We do have to pause. And we will talk about the general who admitted the error, General McKinsey. When we come back, I'm Bruce DuMont. Don't go away. Bruce DuMont back in Chicago. Thanks very much for joining us. We go to Bill Schneider. Bill, another question, a big story this past week, was when General McKinsey went on international television and acknowledged that the recent drone attack was a mistake and resulted in 10 deaths, including 7 children. And he went on and on, I think at length, explaining moment by moment what went wrong. Is that going to be the new modus operandi of U.S. military in the future insofar as garnering world opinion when the United States makes a mistake that large?
Well, God, I hope not. That was a terrible mistake. Yeah. It was an awful tragedy. I think the family is seeking some sort of compensation, maybe even the right to come to the United States. But it was a terrible mistake. And he did it at length, try to explain it and apologize for it. Apparently, we had mistaken one white Toyota for one that included a terrorist. I don't know the details of it. I'm not a military expert, but I know that it was an embarrassment for the military and for the United States. And we hope nothing like that ever happens again.
Some people might be embarrassed by the general's conduct, that maybe he went too far and bending over backwards to apologize. I mean, he apologized, and then he apologized about five or six times, and then he got into the detail of it. And I'm just wondering, especially when reparations might be advisable here, whether or not some people might think that he went too far. Did you think he went too far, Stephanie?
I did, and...
seven children.
Yeah, seven children.
And you were describing it during the break. Yeah.
And I guess the other question I have is, why is he giving the apology? He's fairly, I mean, when you look at the chain of command that issues these decisions and how these, and the protocols that go into these drone strikes, he's actually not at the top of that chain. It was almost as if he was the lowest ranking person who could, you know, with a straight face, come out and give the apology.
Yeah, but he was the man in charge there.
Yeah, but that apology should have come from higher. That apology should have come from Joe Biden.
I don't know that matters. I think the most important thing was coming out straightforwardly after the investigation to tell the world and to tell the American people what had happened, to apologize for a mistake that was made that ended the life of seven children. I think it was a horrible thing to have happened. And if this is the conduct of the military going forward, I think that's an important step in rebuilding our credibility.
Maybe last question, Bill, to you, and that is, one of the reasons why Joe Biden defeated Donald Trump, if you believe that he did, and I do believe that he did, was the American people or many Americans felt that Donald Trump had misplayed the COVID card. Hmm. And my question to you is, there's an awful lot of people who have died on Joe Biden's watch. There's been some confusion and back and forth and conflicting comments out of the CDC and the FDA. Is this clearly Joe Biden's war on COVID now?
Well, he's the president. Yes, it is. Everyone thought we had escaped the worst at the beginning of the summer when the death rate was going down. And all of a sudden, the Delta variant shows up. It had been prominent in Europe. It shows up and everything started getting worse again. Mm-hmm. I don't think people blame Joe Biden for this, but they do expect him to do something. Mm-hmm. And he's doing whatever he can. And right now, he's issued these executive orders for vaccination mandates. Mm-hmm. And to my surprise, they're widely accepted. Americans do understand why we do need vaccination mandates. And they were just approved by a big margin in the recall election in California. That's one of the reasons people supported the governor there, because they support vaccination mandates.
And when a mistake is made, like announcing a program for universal booster shots, only to be shot down a few weeks later, a couple of weeks later, by the CDC and the FDA, or the FDA specifically. Is that just a politician talking too quickly without having the knowledge, or did Joe Biden not listen to the science when he first spoke?
I don't think the science was ever clear. Look, they had an argument within the scientific community over what to do. And apparently there were divisions among doctors and among scientists about exactly what order to issue. I don't think Joe Biden was expected to be a master of the science. He may have acted too quickly in saying he wanted to give everyone a booster shot starting September 20th because it sounded like a good idea. Right. And look, I know a lot of people who've gotten booster shots, even though they don't, under these rules, qualify. It's a very confusing situation, but I don't think people expect Joe Biden to anticipate these scientific judgments when the scientists themselves don't exactly know what's going on.
But I think what we can say is, broadly, the vast majority of Americans are sick of coronavirus, especially if it is possible for policy decisions to end it. We are very ready for those decisions to be made. And I think vaccine mandates for public employees is a good step forward. I really do think that this is going to come to an end in the next 6 months. And I think Biden is going to receive the credit or blame that he deserves.
And again, voters are going to decide in those states where the governors disagree with Joe Biden. There's going to be an election, and the people of that state, be that Florida, Texas, or you name it, they're going to decide whether or not they like what Ron DeSantis has suggested, or they like what Joe Biden has suggested.
That's
so the
right.
voters are going to decide on that in all these other states, and there will be confusion because they frequently are not on the same page.
God bless democracy.
Well, and, you know, what's interesting, though, is we are starting to see the Delta variant numbers are coming down. This may resolve itself by the spring. You know, if we don't see another dangerous variant coming up and, you know, or people are getting boosters.
Is it a political card to play for the Republicans, in your view, Stephanie, or is the COVID going to be an issue that people really want to run away from as quickly as possible when it's no longer life and death in their life?
I think we're going to see that it's no longer life and death in their life, and that I think the Republicans are going to. It's interesting. There are two versions of this COVID battle, and one is the vaccine. The other one are masks.
On that note, we are out of time. Stephanie Hitt, thank you very much for joining us. Patrick Hanley, thank you for joining us in studio. Our thanks to Bill Schneider, who is the veteran writer for The Hill. Bill, it's nice to have you back on Beyond the Beltway. Hope we can do it again.
Thank you.
Our thanks to our good friend Frankie Rodriguez, and also to Kurt Smith, who joined us in hour number one. I'm Bruce DuMont. Good night from Elk Grove Village, Illinois.